All right, let's get going, huh?
Let's go, gather up. Come on now. All right, fellas, you gotta remember your body is like day old rice. If it ain't warmed up properly, something real bad can happen. Yeah?
Athletes take you, Mark. Get set. It's time for the Addict to Athlete podcast. Everybody out there, Coach Blue Robinson here. I want to thank you all so much for downloading, sharing, and subscribing to the podcast. Greatly appreciate you doing so. As always, please keep an eye on that website, addicttoathlete.org. You're going to find all of our backlog podcasts, information about Team Addict to Athlete, how to help kickstart and get to that starting line of your own recovery, and help maybe identify ways that you might be able to help a loved one that could be struggling with mental health, addiction, and so many other things that kind of get us off that path of life. As always, I want to thank everybody for jumping on and giving us a review. It helps get this podcast out a little bit further. So whatever platform you're listening to this on, if you wouldn't mind, jump on there, give us some feedback, rate the podcast, and let's get this into the ears of those who truly need it. Speaking of that website, we now have for registration open our Team Half Marathon coming up in June. This is the No One Left Behind Team Half Marathon. It's a great one to start with because just like in recovery, no one finishes alone. So if you're nervous about running that distance, 13.1 miles, it doesn't matter how fast, it doesn't matter how slow, as long as you all get there together as a team. You register in teams of 3, 6, 12, shoot, 100 if you wanted to, but everyone that starts together finishes together. It's a great experience. It's going to be one of these teamwork kind of effort experiences, and jump on and register for that. It's open, addicttoathlete.org. Well, athletes, I got a great guest in studio today, and one that I've really wanted to talk to for a while, just didn't know that there were people out there that had expertise in this realm. But I got Kaylee Blair, who has been working with and has created her own business to help individuals with traumatic brain injuries and concussions. Kaylee, I want to thank you for being, open to discuss some of this stuff, because what I've seen as a mental health therapist and addictions counselor in the 20 plus years I've been doing this is that traumatic brain injuries, concussions, things that happen to us in youth all the way up to adults sometimes go unnoticed. And it has a big indicator, I think, on, you know, future success and what's going on inside that brain of ours. Would you mind introducing yourself to the listeners? And let's jump into this topic because I think it's going to be a good one.
Yeah, absolutely. Grateful to be here.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I started my own personal journey with brain injuries. I had a couple of big ones around the age of 25. And they weren't your normal concussion type injury where you get hit in the head.
Yeah.
They were different types of injuries. They're more acquired brain injuries.
Okay.
Typically is what they're called. And we can go into those more later if we want
For sure.
But that kind of led me on a journey of recognizing there isn't enough. There isn't enough awareness out there. And there isn't enough help, like accessibility.
Right.
Knowing where to go. And in all areas when it comes to recovering from a brain injury.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I was actually talking with Marissa about earlier was just the fact that most people don't realize that you can work on concussion type symptoms however long. Like there's no such thing as too late.
Wow.
So I created a brain injury coaching business, and I currently am starting to teach some courses as well to help regulate the nervous system, because that's kind of one of the biggest key players.
Right.
So we're starting courses with that. And then I also do a coaching program with a fellow concussion coach, Bethany Lewis, who is also wonderful. And we do a program there together.
That is amazing. I think that traumatic brain injuries, concussions, I don't think that historically we've taken them too serious, because it seems like, let's just take the classic example of teenager high school football, right? Has a brain injury, has a concussion. Coach walks him off the field. Everyone's clapping and cheering because it was an amazing run, an amazing play. Kid sits on the bench, next week he's back in. Now, although everything on the outside, you know, looks good, on the inside, maybe not. And maybe another one and another one. I do a podcast with professional football player Max Hall. And he talked to me about concussions and things of that nature, where one of his career-ending injuries came after a heavy hit and concussion and shouldn't have been playing when he did and got injured. And so why do you think so many of these things go unreported? Because when I first started, you know, doing therapy, and I noticed that there was something off with some of these clients, not everyone, but it seemed a little bit different than the traditional kind of diagnosis. I'm like, there's something else there. And when we do the deep biopsychosocial, and there's the question on there, have you had any head injuries? They're like, well, I did have this, or I did have that. That is a huge red flag. That question shouldn't be buried in the middle of an assessment. It should be one of the top five, I would imagine. Tell me a little bit about why these things go unnoticed for so long. I mean, is it just that kind of neglect or what?
Well, honestly, nobody talks about brain health. not until you become an adult, typically.
Yeah.
I know in my teenage little kid years, it was all about, you know, I lived in the desert in St. George. And so they're like, here's what you do if there's a snake.
Yeah.
Valid knowledge.
Uh-huh.
And then you say no to drugs. You say no to these other things. You learn about like physical health, but they don't mention your brain and what to do to help your brain. And what does a healthy brain look like versus not a healthy brain?
Yeah.
And I know that part of the struggle, I also believe, is that everybody's so unique and different.
Exactly.
And there can be a difference between a learning disability and an injury.
Right.
And they can cross over, but there are different ways to approach each.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's this concept of the whole nervous system, and that includes your brain.
Right.
And so I really think, to simplify it or oversimplify it, I think it's a matter of awareness.
Yeah.
And truly understanding.
See, that's the thing too, right? Is you look at the, you know, that awareness. And again, if the kid gets, you know, rocked by some football play, and he looks good on the outside, why would you think anything's going on the inside, right? And I know that there's been massive improvements in safety equipment and things of that nature, but still, I mean, day-to-day things, life things. Like you said, one of your traumatic brain injuries came not from any kind of accident, but from a surgery. Mm-hmm. And so, like, we don't monitor that stuff enough. So really, the awareness needs to be forefront and center, correct? I mean, like, we've got to be more conscientious about brain health. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what you're saying.
Yep, I am. Yeah. When they talk about wearing helmets, helmets should be cool still. It should be a thing.
Yeah.
They talk about concussion or brain injury can happen from a type of chronic illness that causes strain enough on your nervous system to mimic a brain injury. It can be caused from severe traumatic events. It can be caused from so many various forms that aren't talked about a lot. And they have a lot more research now, and things are improving, but we're always like, wait, catch up.
Yeah.
Get a little bit better and better. So
I just read a report, and it was probably about a week or two ago, that was saying that individuals in the military that stood close to any kind of like heavy ammunition, like cannons or, you know, surface to air missiles or whatever, even the percussion of the sound wave that comes from that repeatedly has now begun to show like heavy, heavy brain impairment, traumatic brain injuries. And of course, the government's like, oh, no, nothing to see here. But the proof's in the pudding. You start seeing some of the, you know, the issues that some of our military folks are coming back with that really didn't have any hand-to-hand combat, but were close to those kind of things. And it's like, wait a minute, this all kind of is connected. And so my first question then to get deeper into this is, I've seen this, and this is just the world according to Blue, a majority of the people that I see in addiction recovery resource programs have and can trace back some kind of traumatic brain injury. What have you noticed is the connection between TBIs, future substance abuse, you know, heavier depression, and things of that nature? What are you noticing?
Wow, various things. There's probably three things that come to my mind first. Mm-hmm. One is when you have a concussion to the brain, one of the first things that tends to struggle is your executive functioning. Mm. Your executive functioning contributes to having a lack of inhibition as well. So everything is linked in your brain.
Right.
So when one area struggles, one pathway is struggling, maybe you're trying to find a new route. Instead of going on a straight shot from A to B, you go from A and you do like a little roller coaster ride and then finally get to B.
Mm.
And oftentimes that creates more effort, creates pain, it can create chronic things if it doesn't get taken care of.
Right.
And kind of like how people will talk about concussion and then post-concussion syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
That post-concussion syndrome is where they've kind of stayed in this chronic state of their brain is going all around and having to really work hard.
Gotcha.
So what that does is the person typically no longer feels like themselves.
Ah.
So I guess I'll speak from personal experience, but this is something I see in everybody.
Right.
That I've worked with. It's been rare not to see it. You typically feel off. I know I felt like I was a stranger in my own body, which didn't make sense because I knew I was in my body, but it was, I felt like a stranger.
So you're like, this is something new. This is different.
And then my emotional regulation was out the window. I could no longer logically think things through. I could no longer speak very well. I stuttered a lot.
Ah.
There's extreme head pain. So all of this stuff led me to a place where if I hadn't had, pretty much by the grace of God, I I didn't go and do certain things that could become severe addictions.
See, and that's the thing I want these guys to get to know is that there's a reason for a lot of this. I mean, again, some people think that addictions just kind of start out of the blue, and they don't. There are traumatic, you know, whether it's emotional, behavioral, or even physical things, you know, and I think we neglect the physical aspects of this. Before we get too deep, and I should have asked you this right out the gate, what is the definition of a concussion? Like, how do we know? Like, how do we even measure this?
Yes. So, and in the brain injury world, there can be, you can find various definitions, but kind of what I try to find the underlying truth amongst it all. Mm-hmm. So typical concussion is like a blow to the head. You get hit playing football. A lot of times with sports, if you were me, you ran into a wall. No, you know, like,
yeah,
like just little things when you're a teenager, you don't even think about, and you're like, well, that hurt.
Right.
Okay, I'm going to move on. And oftentimes you can, and your body is resilient. Your brain is resilient and your nervous system is resilient. And then it's when it kind of layers on mm-hmm. that then it goes, oh no, I don't think I can bounce back as quickly. So a concussion is typically a blow to the head, but there are, if you follow the Brain Injury Alliance or Brain Injury Association of America, they say that an acquired brain injury is can be anything from that blow to the head to, like I mentioned before, like my type where you just wake up and have a brain injury or various modes. It can also, whiplash can have the effect of a concussion as well.
Mm.
So it can be based from your neck. It can be all sorts of various.
So even though I didn't like get the big goose egg on the head, there's still, if you've had any kind of sudden movement to your head, there could be a possibility that there's been an injury.
Sure. And I mean, I don't want to say that in a way to have everybody be afraid of
walking around with
life.
Neck braces and stuff. Yeah, I get it.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But recognizing that if there's been a change in mood, mm-hmm. a change in your ability to regulate stress, and you can link it to a hit to the head, a traumatic event, getting sick.
Yeah.
A lot of people that I've worked with lately, when they have had COVID, sometimes that creates uh-huh. symptoms of brain injury type. And so they go through treatment as well and get help. And it is helpful for them.
That is interesting. I remember one time when I was a youngster, I was probably about 7 or 8. We were living in this apartment in Orem. And the apartment, it was like literally low income housing. And they had this little tiny playground next to it. And all of us were walking on top of the monkey bars. And I remember falling off and that was it. Mm-hmm. Next time I wake up, two of my friends are dragging me to my house and I have no idea what happened in between the fall and getting to that point. And I remember like, cause I had a very absentee mother. Like I remember going up and going to bed and then years later, that is the worst thing to do. Right. Mm-hmm. And I've always kind of wondered about that too, about, you know, those kind of experiences. Cause there's sometimes when those little kids get injured and stuff, they don't tell their parents, or sometimes parents don't quite see it or don't quite notice it. What are some of the heavier, like tall tale signs, if you see someone after a game or you see someone after an accident or something, how does someone from the outside looking in be like, ooh, there's something wrong there? I mean, I'm sure there's a million and one signs, but what can they look for?
One of the first things that can be from someone looking on the outside, if they are extra aggravated, extra irritated, or some of the things that they say or do just aren't, you're like, wait, what? What are you doing there?
Mm-hmm.
But even then, sometimes you can't really tell. So irregular sleep patterns, extreme head pain, neck pain. And a lot of it is just going to be, and that's just it, is that lack of awareness within when you have an mm-hmm. injury like that. You never know until you know
right.
how bad things are, right?
Right.
So looking on the outside, recognizing and giving space for that person and saying, okay, so you just got hit in the head. All right, so we're gonna bench you for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
It's like if we go back to football, and I would definitely give it that game and go see a concussion specialist.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure they can check your vision. They can check for dizziness, headaches. A lot of times, whether they're in the back or the front or all around, they can predict various things from those.
Mm-hmm.
There's really, it's tough. It's
yeah.
tough. And you really have to ask and say, hey, how are you feeling? They're like, oh, I'm fine. I'm just going to shake it off.
Right.
Most often athletes are amazing and
exactly.
resilient.
Yeah.
And you say, okay, great. I love that you want to shake it off. Emotions. How we feel? Are you feeling pretty irritated right now that I'm asking this question?
It's interesting.
Right.
Aggression seems to be one of those commonalities too. It's kind of a weird thing. It's like, They don't want anyone talking to them or whatever, right after an accident. But I've seen that quite a bit. But you have to then know the person too, right? Like, and I've seen this a lot where when we started drilling down and the parents would be like, yeah, you know what? Kind of after those four concussions during his senior year of football, he did kind of change. And sometimes in that teenage years, they all think, well, that's a teenager thing. But is it, right? I mean, I think sometimes we fail to recognize that. I was just telling you before we started recording about a friend of ours that we knew that was in law enforcement and had an accident. And it was very obvious that his whole personality had changed from being an individual who was warm and welcoming and caring to a person who just had no blood-brain barrier, would just say anything.
No filter.
No filter. And it was kind of like, it was weird because it's like, dude, I know you before. That's not you. But that's a symptom. Mm-hmm. How hard is it with those heavier ones for loved ones to kind of be like, wow, this really did change this person? I mean, that's got to be severe if it changes personality, right?
Yeah. I mean, you look at my own history of injuries, and the first one particularly, my family had no idea what to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
The one I feel like saving grace was that I had to move back home. I basically lost all independence.
Oh, man.
For a good chunk. Had to learn how to live life. My parents gave me space. Even if they didn't understand it, they tried to believe me.
Yeah.
When I said, I don't know, my brain is insane. I don't know what's going on. I have no idea what to do.
Man. And
oftentimes it can be difficult to find a good doctor that will be able to get you where you need to go.
Mm-hmm.
I love the medical field. Obviously I love what they
do. I think you're going where I go sometimes. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. But sometimes you have to search. And the first neurologist I saw said, hey, it's just a minor brain injury. Go home. You'll feel better in 4 months. I went home. It was bad.
Take two of these and call me in the morning.
A year later, I finally find this amazing clinic, actually based here in Utah.
Mm-hmm.
There were two clinics I had been thinking and praying about and talking to family about and had to raise money for to go to. And
really?
And finally got myself to one clinic. And mm-hmm. changed the momentum and where I was headed and helped me learn about my nervous system and how to regulate things.
So you full on had to like learn a whole new, I guess, like, dare we say, a career path to a certain degree, because like in order for you to figure it out, you knew that no one else could do it but you. So you're like, all right, I guess this is my new hobby. I'm going to learn everything there is to know about this.
Yeah.
So you wanted it pretty desperately then. You didn't want to just settle.
Brain injured people are some of the most motivated people I've ever met. Because they know what they've lost most of the time.
Really?
Depending on the severity, right? If you, like we have mild, moderate, and severe. If you have a severe brain injury, oftentimes they're not even aware of what's going on, what they're doing, what they've missed. But if you've got more of a mild brain injury, which I hate to say mild because it hinges your whole life.
Absolutely.
But you're aware of what you've missed.
So you were aware of what was and now what is.
And comparing yourself to who you were versus where you're at now.
Really?
Oof. That's a
how do you literally, how do you wrap your mind around that? Because I don't think we understand that concept. I mean, again, I am who I was yesterday. But like, if you're looking back now and being like, I used to love these things, or I used to feel confident doing this, or I used to enjoy this hobby, but now I don't, that's got to be a heck of a wake up call. That would be scary.
It is.
Was it?
Immensely. I would consider myself super spiritual, really close with God, mm-hmm. close relationship. After that brain injury, could no longer feel God in my life.
Hmm.
It was like completely gone. And through a series of experiences and healing, God was able to come back into my life and helped me understand things a little bit better. But that's a testament, I think, to people that maybe they were super religious before concussions and then all of a sudden they're feeling like, meh, I'm good. I don't want this anymore. It's not clicking in my brain. Probably because you need some healing there.
See, that to me opens doors to many deeper conversations about where this stuff like lives inside of our brain. When you're talking about traumatic brain injury, is there a common thread that it seems to affect more than others, or is it anyone's guess? I mean, because I look at that and I think, then that means that spirituality and those things, they live somewhere in the brain. There's that connection there, right?
Absolutely.
And if it gets hijacked or misfiring, mm-hmm. like, how do you wake it back up? Because that to me is amazing that you could reawaken that part to be like, there's that connection. Does that make sense? Like, how in the world?
Listen, I mean, I know this isn't really a religious podcast, but
I think it's important.
Yes, yeah. I agree. Because I didn't feel God, I didn't realize how much God was in my life until I couldn't feel it anymore. And when I couldn't feel it, there was no desire to live. There's no desire to live with a brain that I couldn't get away from because it was like my own enemy. I couldn't control it. I couldn't change it. I was just there in severe pain and suffering, both mentally, emotionally, every aspect of the word. And it wasn't until I had a moment where I recognized that God could pierce through any of that. And I started to have some inspiration to understand who God was to me in my life.
Yeah.
And that in turn helped me remember who I truly am.
Right.
Like at my core. So like there are things in my core that have never changed. I am a very kind person. Right.
So cool.
Like there are certain things that I'm like, these are at my core.
Yeah.
And so having a concussion or brain injury can really give you an advantage in life when you get to that point.
Yeah.
Of being able to understand that.
I can't imagine the difficulties it would be to relearn and reconnect some of those things that were hijacked or lost. You know, that to me is mind-boggling. It's the same concept I would imagine then on that deep personality change. Because I've heard the flip side too, that my husband was the biggest jerk that walked the face of the earth, and then he got in a car accident and he turned into the nicest person.
Right.
That to me is so strange, right? And like, they're like, well, I don't want him to find his old self.
Yeah.
I mean, so that's a hard thing to lean into, but I can't imagine. I don't know if you can even answer this. How in the world did you go? And since it is that spiritual component of you, we're going to drill down on that a little bit more. How were you able to re-engage that? Was it a lot of like observant to the moment? Was it the research you were doing instead of the analytical study? I mean, how do we train ourselves to get back to a level we once were? I mean, you've got to probably put in a massive amount of just time.
Yeah. And honestly, for the first 6 months, I had no idea. Mm-hmm. I tried going to speech therapy because I was stuttering really bad.
Did you know what you wanted to say, but it wasn't coming out?
Yeah. Or it would be too painful to try to think it all the way through to get it out.
Oh.
I would feel it, but I couldn't quite get it out. And sometimes, so I would just go quiet a lot of the time.
Ah. Right? Yeah.
And so it was the process of allowing time and allowing me to like slowly start to.
Mm-hmm.
And the people in my life that were willing to let me stutter and have the time to say what I needed to get out, even if what I said, because at times there were different levels of recovery and finding neuro rehab centers, places where you can have a combination of like physical therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy, who specialize in neuro rehab. That's going to be a saving grace. If I could go back and coach myself, I would start teaching myself right off the bat about your nervous system, what role it plays in your life, no matter who you are, whether you've had a concussion, COVID, addiction, whatever you've got in your life, the nervous system will always play a role and there's always something to understand.
See, that to me is amazing. I've seen this several times, but I have a friend that was in a ward that we lived in before we moved to our current home in Springville, who just suffered probably a year or so ago, maybe a little bit more, a stroke. And this was an individual who was very analytical, very tech savvy, very just engaged. And after the stroke, he's got the same problem, the slow speech, the stutter. And I watch his wife deal with this husband that was here and now not. And my heart just yearns for her because the things that she's learning and the things that she's remembering before and after, some of it's heart-wrenching. How does a loved one start to wrap their heart and mind around some of these changes? Because that's, I assume that when someone comes to your clinic, it's the whole package. It's not just the individual. I'm sure that it's the spouse or the family too. Your family allowed you to just be. And I think that is amazing.
Very rare, I feel like.
I think so.
My dad's a therapist.
Beautiful.
And my mom has been in the health world for a lot of years as well.
So they get it.
They, even though like they would talk to me now about it and they're like, yeah, we had no idea what to do for you. And I said, well, you did
whatever
it.
You did. It was great. Yeah.
Finding validation for your injury is helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Oftentimes people aren't able to. So finding ways, like finding a coach like me or somebody like me who can help you understand how to converse with your family or loved ones and say, hey, this is what I'm experiencing. This is what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm working on this. I would love your help. One tool that I use as a coach is creating a sort of engagement system or functional map.
Gotcha. So
oftentimes we, like in our natural day-to-day life, we go, oh, well, about 3 o'clock I hit a lull, right?
Yeah, your circadian rhythm dips and yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. If we look at finding like a 5-minute break that's going to regulate our nervous system.
Mm-hmm.
And we do that 2 or 3 times in a day, you're going to be 10 times more effective and efficient in your life.
Hmm.
It's not about the grind as much as it is the grind of letting yourself take a little break when you need to.
Right.
So that you can optimize. Because you've got the skill. You've got the ability. You can do it.
Yeah.
It's let's find how to do that.
Let's find out how. And I'm sure it's going to be different for everyone. So you're going to have to be very patient in the individual finding their path, right? Like, you know, the frustration of just, you know, just tell me what you need or what you want versus I'm here. I gotcha.
There's this type of scan or imaging called functional MRI. Mm-hmm. I got mine done at Cognitive FX in Provo. Very cool scan. It tells you a lot about the functionality of your brain.
Really?
Just a regular structural MRI gives you the structure, and that is very valid and needed. You need to make sure and cross off all of the other really scary things.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't until I got a functional MRI that I was like, oh, I'm not crazy.
Yeah.
Oh.
Like, oh, there's the reason. Uh-huh. Oh, my heck.
So, and then that was also when I remember my mom that week, she just sobbed because she went, oh, my gosh.
It's all making sense.
Yeah.
Wow.
You aren't crazy.
You're like, I told you so, right? Yeah.
Well, I
tried
was
to.
Also.
Yeah. Yeah. See, that to me is amazing. And so, you know, in situations like that with a stroke or whatnot, I mean, I would imagine a stroke would be also considered a traumatic brain injury.
Absolutely.
Correct? I mean, that's kind of a given. Where does someone like that start? Because, like, I would imagine that, again, it's going to take time. And time is something that not a lot of us want to spend. We really, you know, want to get it done. When you get into a situation like that, how do you pace an individual versus the loved one, the spouse, the parent, the, you know, the friend? Because I'm sure they're different. How do you coach the two of them? That's like an orchestra you have to try and make into a beautiful symphony to a certain degree.
Right. One of my favorite, I love all of the people I get to work with, but getting to work with couples where one spouse has the injury and the other one doesn't.
Right.
That's one of my favorite things to do. And that question has a lot of depth
it
to
does,
it.
Huh?
I could go a lot of ways.
Yeah.
But one of the best is recognizing you're in this together.
Mm-hmm.
Just because somebody's brain is working slower than yours doesn't mean they're not smart or capable.
Right. Right.
But that also, like, there's a balance. That person who has the injury needs to be aware. So one thing that helped me a lot was recognizing and letting go of my independence for a time. I was somehow blessed with that ability to go, yeah, obviously I'm dealing with something that is outside the scope of most people.
To articulate that.
And I realized, okay, I have to let go. For a while. And
that's a very conscious decision, isn't it?
And it's
it?
Hard.
Yeah.
It's when you have an injury, it's a loss. It's an insane loss.
Yeah.
Very acute. And it ebbs and flows just like any type of loss does, right?
Mm-hmm.
Grieving.
For sure.
So give and take in those relationships. And sometimes, it depending on the severity of their injury, they're not aware of that.
Mm.
So as the spouse or loved one, it can be a matter of you working with them. A lot of times lately I've been looking into research with dementia and some fancy words, TMS, mm-hmm. transcranial magnetic stimulation, and anyways, various different.
What is that? That sounds amazing.
I know, right?
Yeah.
I'm just delving into it myself. I'm curious about it. They're just starting to do more research with brain injuries with it. So technically, as far as scientists are concerned, like, they're not too sure
the
yet.
The jury's still out?
Yeah.
But the information's being gathered?
Yes.
Okay.
And I actually just recently did, they do a test called a QEEG,
mm-hmm.
where they put a bunch of things on your head and they...
Like Doc Brown, Back to the Future, all that stuff on your head?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Except now it's to the point where they don't have to put little electrodes everywhere on your brain or your head. They just put a little cap on, and as long as it's in certain positions, they're able to read the different wavelengths, because every brain uses wavelengths to achieve different states of being.
Yeah.
Right. So they measure those wavelengths for a certain amount of time, and that tells them where their brain's going up and down.
That is amazing.
Anyways, so
I have a question for you.
Sure.
This just came into my head.
Sure.
I remember back when I was going to school back, you know, back in the year 2000, and I remember doing some research on some heavier substances such as like LSD and drugs that really kind of did some damage. And they were doing one with ecstasy, and they were showing how it kills the brain, and it was showing the parts of the brain that was no longer lighting up, that was no longer getting any kind of transmissions. And it looked like there was just holes all over it, right? Because those were shutting down. Long-term substance abuse could also be a traumatic brain injury, right?
Absolutely.
See, and I don't think we realize that too, because after prolonged use of alcohol or substances, there's going to be a huge impairment with that, right? Later on in life, however young you start versus, you know, however, you know, old you are when you decide to quit. That's got to be a gut check too, when if someone was to hook themselves up and start seeing all that kind of stuff. I guess one of my questions is, why do you think, and I'm sure that, again, there's a million and one answers for this, but I'd love your expertise on it. Why do you think traumatic brain injuries typically lead to substance abuse? What do you think the cause and effect is for that? Is it self-medicating? Is it trying to fill something that they can't fill anymore? I mean, what do you think?
Both of those are very good answers.
Oh, good. I'm in the right park.
There's no one answer for that.
Yeah.
So physically, a brain injury creates, like I've talked a little bit about, just to oversimplify it, mm-hmm. essentially when a concussion or brain injury happens, it shifts the pathways that your brain is using to get to certain places to accomplish tasks. And when that happens, your brain has to work sometimes 30, 40, 50, 60 times harder to achieve the same thing, like waking up. Like the ability to regulate those emotions.
Right.
Oftentimes we turn to those substances or other things to be a substitute for that lack of feeling, for the numbness that comes with it, for the pain that you can't get rid of, for the over anxiety. Typically with a brain injury, one of my favorite analogies is that if you imagine kind of like on Inside Out, our brains have that motherboard of all the different knobs. And say one of those knobs is like anxiety, depression, logical thinking. And say with anxiety and depression, those knobs are like at like a one or two in like daily life normally. And then you have something traumatic happen, which creates a brain injury. In turn, that brain injury tends to take those weaknesses and make them 10 times more weak. So for instance, in my own recovery before brain injury, I dealt with anxiety, but I learned how to manage it through various different means. It was, didn't ever have to get on medication. I learned a lot of tools, and I was already in the behavioral health field, and you know, so then after brain injury, it was through the roof. Anxiety, depression. I felt like I was going crazy. I couldn't control my own thoughts. Right.
Yeah.
And when you've got that and you don't have somebody in your life to say, whoa, something's going on.
Yeah.
How can I help you? You're going to turn to whatever you can just to be able to go to work every day.
Right.
Just to be able to try to function.
Yeah.
How you feel like your normal is.
See, and that is such a connection to what I've seen. Again, world according to Blue here. These things I've noticed with certain substances people tend to abuse. I've noticed that those are the behaviors they're trying to suppress. If someone's drinking alcohol or smoking THC or what have you, you're self-medicating depression. Something's in there. The anti-anxiety medications, the barbiturates, all those kind of things. They're not wanting to feel anything. They're not wanting to feel good, bad, anything. They're just wanting to just be numb. You know, and pain medication, something hurts, mental, spiritual, emotional, you know, physical, it hurts. And I noticed that the substances that people use typically reflect something they're going through. So that makes perfect sense. If you had a marked understanding that my anxiety is tenfold now, where it used to be just manageable, and you could understand that and articulate it enough to be like, that's not right. That to me is amazing awareness. Like, I think that is that you are the coolest person because that is the hardest thing I think is to do. We have a hard enough time doing that on a day-to-day life. Yeah. You know, the other day I was sitting in here, I just got done my workout and I sat down and I had this feeling of like just being incomplete, but no motivation to do anything else either. I'm like, dude, what is this? Right. And I'm sitting there thinking like, I just kind of want to cancel my schedule and just go home. That's not like me. Then I realized, hey, dum-dum, you haven't eaten, right? Oh, maybe I should. It was this weird kind of thing, but I didn't, it took me a while to be like that, but I thought, this is strange. A lot of times we don't take the time that we need to fish that stuff out, do we? So we think, well, this is just, and I hate this comment so bad. It's my worst. It's a swear word in my group sessions, everything. It is what it is. I hate that.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
No. Because if you would have said, well, I guess this new life is what it is, we wouldn't be talking right now.
No.
Your life would be completely different. You made the decision of it can always be better or it could get worse. And I don't want it to get worse. How in the world did, I mean, you just did it. So it's like, well, I don't know. It was just kind of what I did.
Well,
that's got to be challenging.
In the process of recovering or grief, you get to this place where you realize, wow, I'm really comparing myself a lot to who I used to be. That person seems really far away and I can't reach that person right now.
Mm-hmm.
Do I say bye? What do I do with that? And do I just accept where I'm at? And I realized, nah, I'm going to become better. I loved that version of Kaylee. Mm. I love her still.
So cool.
But I'm going to become Kaylee 2.0. I'm going to become something better than what I was.
That to me is mind-blowing. So I have a question for you. This might be hard to answer, but I'm going to shoot it at you anyway.
Please.
Was the TBI, can you look at it now as a gift and not a sentence?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Tell me, because I think that is the most amazing thing when people can look at the most difficult thing and be like, I'm a little grateful for it, even though it's like, that sucked, but it's like, but look what happened.
My life wouldn't be as enriched as it is today. I wouldn't have all of the nuggets of knowledge that I have.
So cool.
If I hadn't have gone through those experiences. Do I still cry sometimes because of what I've been through? And I'm in the process of writing my story through those experiences.
Nice.
Boy, it's been a journey just to write about it.
I'll bet. 'Cause
I'm like, whoa, I went through that. There's something about, right, when we, it's like you think about the phenomenon of women getting pregnant and have 3 or 4 kids. They mm-hmm. go through the same pain. They're like, oh, but I could do it.
You could do it again.
Right? And then
running a
like,
marathon. I'll do that again.
Yeah. Just anything mm-hmm. that's painful. You're like, in the moment, you're like, why am I doing this?
Absolutely.
But then after the fact, you're like, I could do that 10 times more, right?
Yeah.
Wouldn't recommend getting another brain injury on anyone, but
for sure.
Are my worst enemies, really. But I'm very humbled and grateful for the depth that it's brought to my life.
Mm-hmm.
I come from the belief that experiences we have in this life are meant to build us and help us.
For sure.
Shape us, right? Mold us into better human beings.
Absolutely.
One of my favorite quotes in learning about the nervous system, fun fact, you have this peripheral awareness, a part of your nervous system. So before you even enter a room, your nervous system is gauging, am I safe? Am I okay? Am I okay to enter this?
Yeah. So interesting.
And a lot of our beliefs play into that. So if we believe that the universe is working for us and not against us, that's going to help a lot.
Guess what? Yeah.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a process. It's, you know, things happen daily to make you feel otherwise. But then
you just watch the news. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or don't.
And I'm sure we don't. I don't.
But, yeah.
I know you don't. You're too happy to watch the news, I can tell.
Thanks. No, but yeah. So
it's just amazing how many things our brain can contribute to just us as a unique being, if that makes sense. Like you said, that ability to be regulated to the point where that nervous system's picking up on everything. That's got to be wild. And I can't even imagine like really slowing down and thinking about your thinking and being like, wait a minute, why am I doing this? What is that? I mean, most of us don't. We're on autopilot so much. But when autopilot gets taken off, all of a sudden you're like flying the plane by yourself. You're like, wait a minute, this isn't really how we did things. And you're very aware that I don't know what half these buttons do.
Mm-hmm.
For you to go back to flight school to learn how to pilot that mind of yours is amazing. But that inspired you to open your program. Like you said, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but you'd mentioned that not a lot of people were giving you the answers to questions that you had. And so you did the research and you started to become, I guess, an industry person that we have a short supply of, which is the concussion coaching and whatnot. Tell me a little bit about your business, what you guys do, and how do people get in contact with you? Because there's going to be some folks I'm referring to you because I know that this is part of the issue.
Yeah, absolutely. Currently, right now, we have a nonprofit called BrainSparks.
Mm-hmm.
We're just kickstarting it. The whole point of it is to create a network community. So people who can't afford coaching, we have them come through and we do an assessment with them. And then we're building a network of coaches, concussion coaches, who are willing and able to donate some time.
Brilliant.
To help these people and kickstart where they need to go, what they need to do, and help them with some of these tools that I've mentioned.
Brilliant.
So I've got that. And then I am currently about to run a course on the nervous system, what it means when it's dysregulated, regulated, and tools to assist it. They can contact me through my website, braininjurycoach.com. They can always call, email, whatever.
Yeah.
And we'll get them where they need to go. We also have a post-concussion success program that I run with another coach. Mm. So there's a lot of different tools.
Yeah,
that I'm working on. There's an app I'm working on as well to help people through that as well.
That is so fantastic. It's such a needed thing. And I know that, you know, the podcast will get out there and get people to check it out. But listeners, please do, because even if you think that, you know, well, it was back in high school, he should be fine now, I would contact Kaylee, because I don't think that any of us should take this for granted. Even if you're the spouse listening to this and you're like, okay, let's say that you're in a relationship with long-term substance use and you're like, things aren't like they used to be. This just seems sad. Contact her, because again, as a network, and like it or not, now you're definitely part of the Addict Athlete family, because I think that what you're doing is going to reflect very well on what we're doing through my private practice of therapy, even to the athletes we work with. And so reach out. Don't just think, well, I guess it is what it is, right?
Yep.
So I think that's amazing. I'm curious, just one more mindset kind of question. The human spirit is amazing. And there is something very unique about the willingness to be that person who doesn't know how to ask for help. I know that one of the most difficult things for even a very strong and healthy brained person is to ask for help. I'm sure it's tenfold more difficult for someone that knows or feels different to ask for help. What do you say to the family or even the individual that's like, maybe I should get checked out, but has a hard time asking for help?
Mm. Very good question.
Because you had to, you know, you had to say, hey, something's up here. And maybe it was a question you asked yourself, like, Kaylee, this isn't you. You need some help. Let's go find it.
Yeah. We didn't talk about this. The second injury I had, they termed it a central nervous system injury, which I was like, okay, fancy term for your brain, your spine, everything's connected, and injury involved all of it. And that one involved my neck, and it brought back old symptoms. And then it brought on a whole host of, I lost gross and fine motor skill in my body. I lost the ability to control my body at that point.
Didn't you say that was from a chiropractic injury? Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So with that, I realized that the people in my life I loved very much, and they loved me very much, but they're human.
Yeah.
They couldn't handle it. And I cried.
I'll bet.
And I got mad and frustrated. Why the heck did this happen? And then I realized, because I love these people in my life, I'm going to ask for other people to help. Mm. I also realized that I'm a very service-oriented person, and I love to assist people. And I just love people. And I realized that one way to love people is to allow people in.
I like that.
So recognizing that you are not a burden, you are a help, mm-hmm. by allowing other people to come in and help.
Brilliant. That is brilliant. So listeners, let that be the invitation, that call to arms, so to speak, that if you suspect, if you think, if you feel, reach out. I mean, there's no judgment in seeing what's out there and available. So much so that Kaylee's created a whole outlet for you, because one didn't exist before. And I love that. That was the one thing I remember one of my professors telling me in graduate school was, if you see a void in your community, it's your responsibility to fill it. And that's what you've done with this. And so, you know, I hope you don't mind, because you're probably going to be a guest on here again, because there'll be lots of questions and whatnot. And I'd love for you to come talk to the group at large anyway. But athletes, you've been well fed today. Please, you know, put this podcast on repeat. And if not too troublesome, please send it to anybody that you might suspect, you know, has a little bit of struggle with this kind of topic. And don't be afraid to talk about it. If you yourself are feeling that way, if you have long-term substance abuse history, reach out, you know. And if you're not in Utah, because I know we get listeners all over the country and world, you know, we'll do our best to help find some resources for you wherever you are. But again, we'd love to have you guys share this podcast. Jump on the website, attitudeathlete.org, for more information on the team. And to always do your best to turn your mess into your message.